Tonight we have husband and wife, award-winning poets, Ned BALBO and Jane SATTERFIELD. As part of this evening's collaboration, I invite you to listen to a song by the 2016 winner of the Nobel Prize for Literature, none other than Bob Dylan.
We're switching.
Okay.
We're switching.
So I'm going to let you.
Leonard Cohen first.
Okay. So Leonard Cohen first. Excellent. Okay. And I introduce Ken Genuard singing and Jonathan Fields on the guitar.
I'm a commercial composer, and we were recording for American Airlines, and we had the whole orchestra out there, and they were tuning up, and the client said, I don't like it. And I said, they're tuning.
Another joke?
A drunken ape midnight choir, I have tried in my way to be free. Like a worm on a hook, like a worm on a hook, like a knight in some old-fashioned book, I have saved all my ribbons for thee. And if I've been unkind, oh, if you can just let it go by. It was never to you. Like a baby stillborn, like a beast with his horn, I have torn everyone who reached out for me. But I swear by this song and by all that I have done wrong, I will make it all up to thee. I saw a beggar sitting on his wooden crutch. He said to me, you must not ask for so much. And a pretty woman leaning in her darkened door, why not ask for more? Thank you. like a drunk in a midnight choir. I have tried in my way to be free.
Thank you, Ken and Jonathan. Wonderful. So afterwards, Father Paul, do you want to talk about the paintings, or do you want to talk about it now?
As you want. What?
Yeah, if you want, you can mention something about the.
Yeah, I guess it's just a short introduction of where you are. As soon as the Green Door Gallery is reopened, just about a year ago, here in the Gallery of Divine Mercy Parish, and I've been opening it with a friend of mine, Elisa Jensen, and so we take turns to curate shows. That I created the Peter show, she created this one. She's a teacher at the New York City School in Manhattan. And this is a new show, so it was hanged yesterday, so she did it like, the opening is Saturday night, but she wanted to do it a little bit before, so the paintings would be here for the poetry reading tonight. So she worked hard to get everything ready, so the gallery would be beautiful. Mm-hmm. And yeah, so welcome to all of you, and very happy to host the poets, Rita, Crossroads, long time friendship, and
yes.
Looking forward to hearing you.
Yes, thank you, Father Paul. So, most people think of poetry as a solitary pursuit. Yet, as one of our guest poets, Jane Satterfield, says, as artists, we stand on the shoulders of giants. Poetry is a collaboration with the art that came before, but also with the created world. Our second guest poet, Ned BALBO, when speaking about his craft, explains, I try to write poems that aren't just personal, but also capture that exact moment when ordinary lives pass into history, moments that carry the imprint of those we love or who've affected us deeply. History and memory are intertwined. Tonight we have the great privilege of making history and creating memory with husband and wife team Ned and Jane as they read from their poetry, sharing who and what inspire them and how they move from inspiration to form. Now for a little biographical information. Ned BALBO's Three Knights of Persides won the 218 Richard Wilbur Award. His previous books include Upcycling Palmanook, Lives of the Sleepers, awarded the Ernest Sandine Poetry Prize, Galileo's Banquet, the Townsend University Prize co-winner, and The Trials of Edgar Poe and Other Poems, awarded the Poets Prize and the Donald Justice Prize. His next book, The Silver and Touch Me Nots, was selected for the new Criterion Poetry Prize and will appear in the fall of this year. He is the recipient of the National Endowment for the Arts Translation Fellowship for his version of Paul Valéry's La Jeune Parc, 3 Maryland Arts Council Poetry Grants, the Robert Frost Foundation Poetry Award, and the winner of the 2019 New York Encounter Poetry Contest. Ned was recently a visiting faculty member in Iowa State University's MFA program in Creative Writing and Environment. Jane Satterfield has received awards in poetry from the NEA, Bellingham Review, Ledbury Poetry Festival, Ms. Lexia, and more. Her books of poetry are Her Familiars, Assignation at Vanishing Point, Shepherdess with an Automatic, and Apocalypse Mix, selected by David St. John for the 2016 Autumn House Poetry Prize. Jane's nonfiction has received the Florida Review Editor's Prize and Pirates Alley Faulkner Society Award. New essays are out in Hotel America, Superstition Review, Animal, A Beast of a Literary Magazine, and Diagram. With Lori Kruk, she co-edited the multi-genre anthology Borderlands and Crossroads, Writing the Motherland. And she recently taught a poetry course, Flash Fiction, and micro-essays on apocalyptic and dystopian topics at Loyola University, Maryland, where she is an associate professor in the writing department. And now I give you Ned and Jane.
Thank you, Rita. Thank you, Father Paul. Thank you, Crossroads Cultural Centers. It's wonderful to be here. And it's been such a dark and dismal spring. It's just so wonderful to be surrounded by this beautiful, these beautiful colors. So I'm going to start out with a poem from my book, Apocalypse Mix, which sounds dire, but is not entirely. Both my parents' lives were deeply influenced by war. And so I think as a young person, I was very struck by the collision of history, memory, and also the way that people went to great efforts to preserve and honor community and to pay tribute to things they loved and to make the most of what they had. And this poem is called Parachute Wedding Dress. There's a parachute wedding dress example in the Smithsonian Museum, which you can look up online, and it's a beautiful example of the way that women collected parachutes and made various clothing items out of them. I have a picture of my mother as a very young child with a parachute ribbon in her hair. So this poem sort of pays tribute to that. Parachute wedding dress. More fetching than the gowns themselves, sail white and confectionery sweet, are the stories concealed in pieced panels, in cascades of hand-edged ruffled rose, the work of savvy tailors or sentimental brides whose husbands-to-be held fast to nylon or best silk that saved them as they sunk from sky to beachhead, from burning bombers to uncertain fate in freezing fields behind enemy lines. For his fiancée's dream of a white wedding dress, one survivor in a displaced persons camp traded 2 pounds of coffee beans and several packs of cigarettes for a German pilot's useless parachute. And on the close, my mother's blacked out English street, canny mothers shared out salvage fabric for hair ribbons and christening gowns. How distant now, that world of rationed goods, in museum cases, in picture perfect resolution, such economy and love handed on and handed down, its life and afterlife. And I think that a lot of what the work that we do as poets is saving that salvage fabric and honoring the people we love.
So I think we're just going to hand these back and forth, and just but I wanted Jane to have a little bit of a spotlight there. It also lets me avoid the spotlight a little bit longer. So I'm not sure. We kind of looked at each other's poems and said, well, maybe we can make this a sort of coherent program. But given the folks that have shown up and what we know of some of them, and of course they're total strangers as well, I think it may be more of an improvised program than we expected,
okay.
More by free association, but maybe we'll hit on some of what we planned. So in response to that, this is a poem called Snow in Baghdad. It's a blank verse, 14-line poem, so it may be a blank verse sonnet, or if you feel strongly that sonnets must rhyme, then it's not. And it's inspired by actually a true story I read everywhere in January of 2008. There was snow in Baghdad, and the poem captures that, and I thought it was a powerful metaphor of, you know, the need for peace and how fragile and fleeting it is. So I wanted to capture that in the poem, inspired by the news stories I was reading. Snow in Baghdad. The snow so rare that people call it rain. Wet flakes touch earth and pavement, ruins and wreckage, the muezzin's call to prayer, the morning's music calmer, quieter. 5 years of war, and now this peace, unasked for, temporary, Americans in desert camouflage, stationed conspicuously, brushing snow from shoulders, guns, while snowball fights ensue among the young. The sound of Arabic, English in softer tones, spatter of white on impact, laughter as the traffic slows, checkpoints and concrete walls disguised, erased, and one old resident exclaims in wonder, "In all my life, I've never seen such rain." And I think that comment, calling the snow rain, seeing it as a type of rain, I found to be quite moving.
Yes.
So I mentioned that my parents were deeply influenced by war. My father's American, my mother is British of Irish extraction, and I lived in the UK for a year, 1994 and 1995, and that's where my daughter was born. So like myself, I was born in the UK. She has dual citizenship. And this poem kind of looks at the day that we went to file for citizenship for my daughter, and it also pays tribute a little bit to an encounter that I had with a Muslim woman who, we had a language barrier, we couldn't speak, but she wanted to talk to my daughter and see my daughter, and so the poem kind of speaks to that moment. It was a poem that I wanted to write about for many years, and it wasn't until about, I guess, about 20 years after the event took place, where there were some, the war was going on, I began to write about this, and this poem's called Triptych. I had a day's underground pass, forms to be filed for your passport. Soon we'd fly back to the States if your paperwork was in order. Your father stood watch in the embassy, ready to call us in when needed, while I wheeled you round the garden in summer's equatorial heat. I shifted the sunshade over your face. Down the path, a stranger neared, shopping bags in her hand, headscarf adorned with flowers, petals scattering light in dark. In this time before fear was everywhere, what was the reason she caught my gaze? Nearly two decades on, my screen flickers with images of crowds and crusades, flags set aflame, placards facing off outside the same American embassy, Afghanistan's the graveyard of soldiers. If you want Sharia, move to Saudi. Rage tilts toward extremes. Citizens are advised to review the worldwide caution, stay current with media coverage. The camera passes across the roiling crowd, one side against the other, Londoners who'd banish all immigrants, Muslim protesters garbed in white. How to speak of what we share, what separates us? If there's a woman in the crowd, I don't see her. But I remember the day I waited with the pram, how you blinked as I pulled back the sunshade and you tugged your tiny bonnet, clenched fist unfurling. In time's reflecting pool, water gathers, builds to spill. That stranger, alone, hesitant, reached in to touch your face. What was her past? A dream of mosquito nets, flashing rain, the cardamom pods she bought for her mother. She saw a mom with a pram and neared, touching the face of a stranger's baby, smiling as she said, beautiful, as she said, blessed.
I think we live in a time when a lot of not very pleasant things are happening in the news, which is a vast, vast understatement. And I think, you know, probably, you know, like a lot of white guys of my generation, you know, you want to believe, or you've grown up believing things that you now know are not true, like that mostly the police are probably to be relied upon, but every so often there are some bad ones that do awful things. And I think by now, there have been so many stories and so many things going on inescapable in the culture, so much that's been filmed and shown on video, that it's pretty hard to live with that. I have police in my family as well, so you know it's a tough truth to face that there's such an endemic problem, such an extensive problem, so many people just being killed for no reason at all. And of course, part of the surprise of it is you would think, like, imagine yourself 20 years ago, you would think, well, gee, if this stuff was filmed on a cell phone and everybody saw it, this would stop it. It wouldn't happen anymore. And yet, it keeps happening. It keeps happening again and again. And the trials happen, and people get off, and you're just astonished how deeply ingrained it is. So this is a poem in response to that, because there's a lot in this new book, Three Knights of the Percy. It's about technology and about how it's reshaping things, perhaps for the worse. I'll read happier and funnier poems later. This is not one of them in response. But in response to your poem, which is also a political poem, this is called Cell Phones Lifted in the Public Square. What sign of progress is it when videos gone viral capture every shooting we're helpless to prevent? Our only choice, to watch, refuting every frame, or look at what we see, bearing collective witness. Car keys, a toy, a wallet, some everyday possession looks just like a gun. Who wouldn't freeze, shoot first? Yes, all can be explained away ingeniously, each prop or passerby vital to the moment. Who's lost, who's culpable? The audio fades or fails, the actions blurred, unsteady. The watchful eye relentless, and right on cue it happens. A firearm's discharged, though we close our eyes, though the view is shaky. There'll be protests, altercations, alerts, and interviews. Am I next? Scrawled in chalk beside a body's outline, and flashing on phones and screens, footage that never ends. Who calls for an indictment? Who's listening? Who mourns? Soon, when twilight vigils fill the public square, challenging a narrative that casts blame on the dead, the crowd will raise its cell phones, so many they'll look like stars, viewed from far away, the distance of history. Held high, what will they offer? The light of evidence, the need for a just verdict, the promise of contrition. But the dead keep adding up, and the shootings will go on, just as they always did, obscure and unrecorded, surveillant of lawful murder, indifferent to truth, unmoved, essential and ineffective. You shine light, but change nothing. What must change in us who bear collective witness to all this grief and guilt, inexorable as ever?
So how did you write that poem? How about that? What is the process behind that?
I declined
to answer. That's fair. A lot of people ask us questions about, like, what's it like to live with another poet, and do you give each other ideas, and things like that. So I wanted to read a poem that kind of addressed that question. But it's also a poem that looks at my father's experience. My dad was in the military. He enlisted as an 18-year-old, and he was sent to England, and that's where he met my mother. So I came back to the U.S., and I was about three. So that was one of the boons of his service. But he was called up, so he became a reservist. And then my family sort of joked around, I have four brothers, and we joked around that my dad's service as a reservist paid for our liberal arts degrees, so we are indebted to him. But during the first Gulf War, he was called up. And so this poem kind of looks at that. But several years ago, we were sort of wandering around a local store, and there was a little jar of something called Combat Ready Bomb, which had been made by someone who was a vet, and it was a salve that you could use for sand flea bites that was often sent to the service people. So Ned bought it for me and said, this would be a really good thing for you to write about, and I was like, yeah. But suddenly, I said, okay, I'll take the challenge, and I did write about the poem, and the poem also looks at the kind of balm that we seek to offer those who do military service. So this is called Combat Ready Balm. No contest at $12.50 a jar, a must-have for the medicine cabinet, soothing salve for sand flea bites, sunburn and dry skin, a cocktail of good wishes, wrapped in field green and red trim, hopeful appeasement, like the St. Christopher medal I gave my dad. After the 4:50 night's midnight call, the usual round of inoculations, the botulin and anthrax vaccines, just like that, he was part of the mission, off to Gulf One with the military airlift command. Nothing like flying the friendly skies. Just like me, to offer an apocryphal saint as protection, a saint whose feast day was dropped from the church in record of absence of historical evidence that he'd ever existed. You've heard those stories of letters, notebooks, and Bibles tucked into breast pockets, how they could stop a bullet's path. There's no shame in sending off loved ones with a charm. Patron of travelers, invoked against storms and plagues and every etc., does it matter if Christopher's simply a stand-in for the soul treading turbulent waters? About the bomb itself, well, it's good to know it's environmentally friendly. Essential oils, no petroleum, nothing synthetic. Especially good, given the billions it costs to outfit tents with AC. Good, given the dangers to troops on the ground, whom you fuel to distant outposts via a network of slightly upgraded goat trails. I hate to think of the youths and family men and women lining up at Air Mobility Command, the same site where they filmed the video promotion for Combat Ready Bombs Operation Sand Flea. Once I boarded an Air Canada flight, a soldier smiled, looked straight into the camera, saying nothing of stress or mission fatigue, smiling in desert camos, commissioned to say how much he wants us to know how even a small thing helps. Nearly 20 years on, uniform turned in, my father still wears his medal.
This is a poem about my own dad, who I know you saw a few times, Josh, back in freshman year when he was dropping me off at Vassar.
Yep.
And I'm adopted, so I don't look at all like my dad looked, which is a cause for a lot of interesting experiences in my life, I have to say. This poem actually, I think, has certainly moments that are thinking of Brooklyn. My dad grew up in a Greenpoint, but on Humboldt Street. So I'm not sure where the board boundaries are, but and I'm so angry because I didn't look at the Ancestry.com census sheets as I wanted to before I came here to find out the exact address. I know it, but I forgot to look, and I can't actually look at his house. So next time I come. And he had three sisters, and St. Teresa was his patron saint, and he always prayed to her and kept her statue around. Like many Italian men of his generation, he was born in 1919. It took him probably till his 60s or 70s to really become religious, but suddenly he was very religious. And this is called A Word the Romans Used. It begins with an epigraph by Dana Gioia. The Latin word for poetry, carmen, is also the word the Romans used for a song, a magic spell, religious incantation, or prophecy. And my dad's name was Carmine. A word the Romans used. Carmen, the Latin word for poetry, is the same word the Romans used for song. My father Carmine played accordion. His sisters called him Carmen. Were they wrong to hear his music as an incantation, off the beat, bound to a single key? A magic spell, a song, a prophecy. Each holds the power to lift us. For how long, clouds breaking, did a dark sky hold the sun? Was it a star in motion all along? My father's namesake was Mount Carmel's vision. Ailing, he kept her scapular nearby, useless without the right words. When he'd pray, I'd think, words for the old or very young. Carmen, his sister smiled. They loved to listen. Carmen, Carmine, Carmel, on each tongue that knew which name to speak or leave unspoken. Mary, an apparition. Borne away, the bellows resting on his knee, he'd sway. Who were these women she was blessed among? Each word a child speaks puts stars in motion, or twice blessed, they stay where they belong. Words bring the charm, become the talisman that summons Carmen, prayer, and poetry. That was the diatonic accordion he played, you know, so you can't really change keys, or, you know, so it's not easy.
So I wanted to read a poem that's a little bit of a love poem, and it's called "On Valentine's Day I Pick Up My Wedding Dress," and it I think it, part of it takes place in Baltimore, part of it takes place in Venice, so that's and one thing that's interesting to note, that the first stanza of the poem begins with a long description of a wedding dress. And certainly one of the great ekphrastic traditions comes from, I think, the Iliad, where we get the long description of Homer's shield. And so I guess the female tradition is to describe the wedding dress. So this is "On Valentine's Day I Pick Up My Wedding Dress." Dragged across a sculpted lawn, hem half undone, the Sophia long ivory silk was smeared with August grass, a thrill to wear the empire waist with shirring at the bust, complete crossover detail and tiny shoulder pleats, the bit of luxe I delayed for months putting into the cleaner's hand. I loved how it dangled amid the darker palette of my wardrobe with its tattered trail of snails, Prosecco, pollen, one niece's sandal print, another's cookie smears. Any of my black slip dresses would have done the job, but my tween daughter said, "It's supposed to be a celebration, Mom, not a witch's Halloween." Several years ago, she and I walked with you, old friend, new love, along the Grand Canal. A wedding party's passing stopped the swirling crowds. In upraised arms, the unveiled bride held her baby girl. Noonday sun, the streets still puddled with morning's tide. But her dress, my daughter said, just ate, thinking of ruined fabric, the dirt and grime, where I thought the world's full bouquet. Today's poems in class were sex, not love. Sex and Singles Awareness Week. My cynics beyond their years didn't even Google Valentine, imprisoned bishop who worked to keep lovers' hope aflame. I gave out chocolate, wishing for some grand passion to sweep them away.
Yeah, just sort of a love poem about getting married to my husband. Just sort of, kind of. Don't hedge, please don't hedge. This is a sort of a love poem.
Sort of.
If I can find it. And a while back, Jane and I were at the Virginia Center for the Creative Arts. And I'm not the most athletic person, nor have I spent much time, you know, riding the wild range on the back of my steed. So running into a horse in the darkness, you know, seemed creepy and disturbing to me. And so even though it's called Dark Horse, which is much is as redolent, I'm sure, of George Harrison's record label and his famous single as it is of what we saw, Dark Horse, Jane and I were walking around at a writer's artist colony and saw a horse in the night. So it is what it says it is, Dark Horse. It's another blank verse, 14-line poem. This moonlit night, we've come upon a horse. His equine profile looms above barbed wire so close, we might have touched him accidentally as we pass along this country road. On foot, our flashlights, small moons flicking off. We don't want to startle him. He's still, and we can't see his eyes. Is he asleep, awake, and watching us, or in the grip of dread? He might be dangerous at night. Mm-hmm. By day, he's chestnut brown, but now he's shadow, eyes invisible, mane moonlight tinged, the hills behind him dim, vertiginous with all the history his kind have known, entwined with ours each day and every darkness.
at the same writer's colony, sometimes when you go to an artist colony, people say, why do you go with your spouse? As if your spouse is something to escape.
Surely you're here to fool around.
In a moment where I was not with my spouse at the same colony where we saw this horse, a fiction writer said to me, oh, you're a poet. I guess you're going to write about the cows in the meadow and other pastoral stuff. And I had started working on this book, which was largely about war. So I thought, oh, this would be very funny. I'll explain to this fiction writer why I don't write nature poems. And so this is why I don't write nature poems. Because I'm always wearing the wrong shoes, I rarely stray from the path. There's recollect, there's tranquility, and the way the trains punctuate each hour, shrill the shaken fields. Let's bide a bit here, thinking why we love them, the tracks, the transit. Trains a metaphor for so many things in life, like me. Busy eyeing up the buffet from the back of the line, too busy to consider a phalanx of flocks, the tabby stray cavorting in the hedge. I don't see a cow meadow as any kind of invocation. I'm drawn to the satellite dish disrupting the view, to the one swatch of sky where the haze hangs, because truly, the one time I tried, the saddled mare extended an answer, his hoof on my foot, a fine form. Because the genius of the place can drop a scroll of sycamore bark at my feet, and I still can't translate his tongue. Because a cicada's buzz in the topmost branch is all the intel left to get, trilling a telling, here, here, I am here.
So I'm open to some other singing here. If I can find it. Here we go. I promised I would read a poem about Vassar. This one contains the F word. Can I read that? Or should I just mouth it?
No.
Why don't I just mouth it?
Father Paul said okay.
It's okay. Josh, I don't know if you were there. This is a Patty in Orbit. It takes place at the Vassar College Chapel, April 7th, 1979. I'm a big Patti Smith fan. This was not a tour in which she was at her best. There's actually a wonderful account of it in the Vassar Miscellany News, the college newspaper. I stole a few lines from it and actually gave credit to the author, David Duncan, in the notes, so I'm not just a plagiarist. In case you're wondering, this is in sapphic stanzas. If you don't care, that's fine too. Patty in Orbit, Vassar College Chapel, April 7, 1979. And it also helps to know that she has a song called Space Monkey on her album Easter. And it's exactly what you'd expect it to be about. Patty, what was audible past the ceiling? Beams of dark wood, terminal angels watching from above, winged guardians halved and gilded, space monkeys, feedback? Fixed on high, celestially overhead, blank faces stayed blank, glimmers of stage lights flashing over us, your audience in the chapel. Why were you awful? You were high too, obvious from your banter. Where are all the good-looking models? Fuck it, I don't feel like reading tonight. Your book slammed shut as the band played fiercely, stoned too, high on rebellion, missing half its text, the poem at its core and climax. Strobe lit Len, guitarist of poison power, drug-dazzled, soloed. How high were we after such hype and clamor? Were you crashing, spiraling downward fast, or off course temporarily? Mm-hmm. No, I never play a gig just for women, or play only for humans, either. You replied to stage crowding hedonists. What did my girlfriend, classically trained pianist, think of this bedlam? She took things in stride, a distinct advantage at that time for anyone dating me. But where was he, ape avatar, fueled and starstruck, racing the night sky? Patty, close to spinning away, you landed safe and sober, marrying in Detroit Fred Sonic Smith, typed pages and more. Smiths followed, raising a family, music on hold. This was the life that saved you and the choice that later on left you widowed, fired with grief, inspired to resume recording after the fade out fades out. What's next? Maplethorpe, memoir, tributes, time bearing down. Space monkey, high that evening, locked in quaalude orbit beyond the solar asteroid belt, or radar jammed, craft plunged in Pacific waters, sky blue by day. Alien ape, lost pilot, will we know you? Simian gold and glowing when you appear? Or will Patty summon you back to grimace at the sight of what was but one more planet on your journey, no more or less important when it's forgotten? And the locked in quaalude orbit beyond the solar asteroid belt is the line by David. Oh, it sort of suggests a rhythm. So there you go, the one with the sapphics. Now, I'm not quite sure how much time we have. We certainly don't want to, like, you know, read you into numbness. Obviously, Rita asked us to talk a little bit about how our poems are composed, a little bit about our process. She said there'd be a Q&A. So maybe we should read each, maybe one more poem, and then we'll take questions if there are any. It also gives you a little pause in case you want to slip away. And, you know, perhaps you have other things to do. That's okay, too. So. Go with Emily.
Okay. So I was just telling a few people that part of the joy of this week, aside from finishing a teaching semester, was that I was able to work in the New York Public Library's Bird Collection and look at some poems and manuscripts by Emily Bronte. I'm working on a new project inspired by the Bronte family and the way it's sort of looking at neo-Victorian legacy and the way these this family's lives sort of proliferate in the 20th century and the questions they raise about biography. And I've been fascinated for them probably my whole life, and I said, you know what, I'm just gonna like write about them. It doesn't matter whether anyone cares. So it's been a joy to go to the library and the Bird Collection, and they let you into the archive and you see they bring out pieces bit by bit. You know, you can't look at everything all at once, which of course if you're a poet you want to see it all. And you have to like fill out little call forms, which are very specific. You have to get them right or the librarian will correct you. So it feels a little bit like being in school, but then they bring out these pieces, little torn shreds and pieces. And you can see that people in the Victorian era are so careful about their use of paper, right? Because paper is very expensive, paper and ink. And so just looking at these little slips and time kind of drops away. So that's part of the project I've been working on. And a poem that I wrote early in the collection was inspired by reading Emily Bronte by Long Island Sound. There's a wonderful conference called Poetry by the Sea, which is on the Long Island Sound, and it takes place at the Mercy Sisters Retreat House, and it's sponsored by a friend of ours, Kim Bridgeford. And it's a wonderful conference. In fact, it's the only literary conference I've been able to go to where I actually can write something. That's how peaceful it is. So anyway, this is that poem, Reading Emily Bronte by Long Island Sound. Life is short and art is all, and the day is dazzling, a glassine surface. The clouds a mottled counterpane, the few spays blue, ring-billed gulls parse the tide, no lark or heather bells, just pages where the seasons swing. You walked away from village chatter toward the waterfall's campaign, up moorland paths where a wind beat a path through grass, such license in stolen afternoons where you saw hidden constellations, the silver trail of snails, a fistful of bees roused from sleep. Your dress was a welter of thunder clouds and lightning bolts. Today I'm claws and flutter sleeves. Would you say the here and now's a horizon to eternity? An ancient ice sheaf engineered this estuary, a sheltered tide that slows the pulse, one mercy in a warming season.
Jane says I should end with this one, so I will. This is a sonnet about a bar in Iowa, but I think it's universal in the lament that it offers. Time's passage at Whiskey River, and of course the epigraph is free beer tomorrow. We've all seen that sign. And suddenly at 12:01 felt that terrible disappointment when tomorrow was suddenly today and no free beer was
for tomorrow.
You know, when we realized we've been tricked yet again by the world. Time's passage at Whiskey River. I read the sign, it's late, tomorrow's near. The beer's flat, no one taps another keg. The shortstop stumbles on the runner's leg while frozen strangers balance at the bar, slow motion gestures wasted on the air. Outside, the tattooed girl takes one more drag while friendly foes attack the punching bag that offers glory to the challenger with change to spare. Surprised, the shortstop blinks, eyes flashing back and forth in diamond dust. Young men with sunken cheeks wait for the drinks the tattooed girl withholds, because she must, when all our hopes, past midnight, turn to sorrow. There's no free beer today. And none tomorrow. Thank you, Rita. Thank you, Father. Music we had playing us in. I'm not sure if now's the moment for more music or if that's going to come soon.
Well, we're going to have Q&A.
Okay, Q&A.
And then we'll have music, and then we'll have food, right?
Oh,
right.
Free wine.
And wine.
Free wine today.
Yes. Yes, today at 12. So actually, could I begin with a question?
Absolutely.
My question is, when you... I'll throw it to both of you and whoever wants to field it. When you have an idea for a poem, how do you know if you want it to be a sonnet or you want it to be, you know, a couplet or a free verse, or like, how do you know the form that the poem is going to take?
That's a great question. and I'm thinking, like, primarily I write free verse, but I'm very interested in, and from going to writers' colonies, I've discovered that my process is very similar to composers. From what they tell me, like, they hear, like, they have a sense of a theme and what they want to explore, and then they wait for the music. And they're sort of crafting toward sustaining that music across the line. And that's kind of what I do with free verse. So often it's about knowing and being obsessed with a subject and feeling compelled by a subject and getting a title and a first line that set the music. And then I've got to go from there. Other times I have a sense that I'm working with a subject that fits a particular literary form. I like forms of repetition like pantoum or villanelle, where there's repetition and refrains that are set. When I'm working on this project about Emily Bronte, for example, I thought, I want to write a poem about the Kate Bush video, Wuthering Heights. Many people probably know that 1980s famous video. And there's actually flash mobs that recreate that video. So I thought, oh, that seems to lend itself really well to the structure of the villanelle, which has like the first and third line repeating, and then it goes through several stanzas. For me, like, maybe that's kind of how things work. But you work more strictly in forms than
in meter. Since my 30s, I've been, and I think I would say that if you're, I think when I was first starting out, I would often choose subjects that didn't fit the form I thought I was trying to write in. If I had a very specific subject, a specific idea, and so then I would say that if it wasn't working, then I would either write a poem that didn't work, or I would switch to a different form that I thought would fit better. So, for example, if it was a lot of narrative and it turned out to be, you know, too heavy for a sonnet, then I'm like, okay, maybe I'll turn this into a blank verse poem because I'll have a lot of room for it, or a free verse poem too. I've certainly turned bad blank verse poems into better free verse poems and publish them too. That's happened a few times also when there's just too much filler and my skill just wasn't there, you know. But then sometimes you get the sense of like, oh, this will either match the form. I just have a moment I want to write about.
Like, and so, Free Beer Today.
Free Beer Today. This is not epic. You know? It needs something short, tight, move on. No, that's the
jingle.
Best.
Yeah. Yeah.
A jingle. There you go. Yeah. Look, there you go. And you would know.
Yeah.
If you ever need a lyricist. You know. but in any case. But then, you know, other things obviously demand more, and you want more room for them. So in that case, maybe poems of indefinite length can help. If there's some weird thing that keeps happening or can be varied upon, then poems with refrains that repeat mm-hmm. themselves can be very useful because, oh, you can keep returning to this and it will come back in a different form. And in the case of the poem I read about Patti Smith, then, you know, there was a line in an article on the concert that suggested a music. I said, oh, well, this is a trochaic sound, so it fits sapphic stanzas, and I think that will be. And I remember the question that the women in the front row had asked. You know, would you give a concert for women? And she said, but I wouldn't give it for you. Wouldn't do it only for humans either. And so I thought, oh well, this kind of fits then. It's kind of like the sort of connection of, you know, women's experience. You know, she's a woman artist, so I thought that would fit. And that was also, and it's also sapphic stanzas, but I could write as many as I wanted, so I could like fit the narrative into them.
Mm-hmm. Thank you. John.
You talk about music a lot, and you just brought up rhythm. Do you have any opinions on that as poetry?
Oh. Yeah. Well, I mean, my opinion is, let's see. I mean, I think that rap is really great, and I think it obviously depends on the artist, just like whether it's music. I mean,
right, the form itself. Does it approach what you guys do?
It's something entirely different. I mean, and I don't think that the way I usually put it to my students is that if you have rap or you have lyrics in a song, there's a tremendous overlap with which poetry is. If you drew a Venn diagram and you said, you know, rap, you know, song lyrics, you know, poetry, and there'd be overlap, you know, but there are some things that work in rap or that work in song lyrics that don't work in poetry. And also there's stuff in poetry that doesn't work when it's sung. I mean, I can think of some Dylan Thomas poems I've heard set to music by John Cale, and they're so densely verbal that the sounds are too sonorous and too heavy to be sung comfortably.
I've thought that about poetry too. It has so much content.
Yeah.
Music, it's hard to find the music.
Yeah. Right, and if you have lots of Lou Reed lyrics, you know, and they don't read very well as poetry, I would argue. But I think that they're, you know, they sound great in songs.
Mm-hmm.
And I think the same thing is true in rap. But I think that I think also there's an interesting thing going on in the culture where people use what defines poetry as a way to sort of gain some kind of higher ground. And the reason I say it that way is people say, well, this is poetry, but that's not.
Mm-hmm.
So someone says, well, rap is not poetry. It sounds like an insult, and it shouldn't be, because I think that, you know, rap is sort of connected to performance.
Mm-hmm.
And so if you sing a song and it's connected to performance, and you rap and it's connected to your performance, and the voice of the performer, the presence of the performer, that's all part of it. It's all
mm-hmm.
connected. A poem that, like the kind I write, that I do, and a lot of literary folks do, we're trying to write something that anyone could read it, and it would somehow have a music to it.
It's not performer-based.
Whereas the performer is like putting the music sometimes in, but not always, because as I said, there's a Venn diagram of overlap with a lot of great language that's going to be in all of them.
Well, look at Lin-Manuel Miranda
in
Hamilton, where you see the use of rap and all those conventions, and the rhyme is providing tension for the narrative, and it's driving the narrative forward, and it's framing it in very interesting and syntactical ways. And I know sometimes I'll have students who want to use the conventions of rap, but they're writing toward the rhyme, and the rhyme is dictating the piece. And I know Charles Martin has talked about sometimes, he's a wonderful translator, but you have to sacrifice the rhyme for the greater goal of the art. And I think, you know, Hamilton is a great example of how like the best rap can really work artistically.
You know, I'm not immersed in rap, but you know, I think of like albums like Jay-Z's Black Album, an autobiographical album of his life, which I think is really powerful and really. I don't have to say is this poetry or not. I just think it's a great album and the songs are great.
The Fugees,
Okay,
certainly.
Yeah.
We show our age.
Our age, yeah.
The 90s. What can you say?
Yeah.
You had a beautiful example about the Sandfleet bomb.
Oh, yeah.
I loved Ned picking up the product and the receptivity with which you
took up the assignment.
Could you talk a little more about how you collaborate and the kinds of ideas you give to each other that way and so forth?
Well, I'll start and you continue.
Absolutely.
Jane will encourage me. So for example, I like conspiracy theories and strange lies and things that people believe that can't possibly be true, but they believe it anyway. So I was talking about people that don't believe that the moon landing never happened. And, you know, and I do a lot of improvising of, you know, what can only be called bullshit, like with my wife, you know, just to entertain her. And so I said, oh, you should put that in a poem. So I stayed up one night and said, okay, I'm going to write this. I wrote a poem called The Lunar Deniers, which is going to be in the forthcoming book about folks that just don't believe in these. This guy is very reasonably explaining how it never happened, and of course it's all a fake. So there's things like that. That's one example from my life.
Yeah. I know, like this book, Her Familiars, I think this book is an example of a book where I kind of took up the assignments. I've been writing a memoir and doing a lot of nonfiction. I wrote a nonfiction memoir and was teaching a lot of nonfiction. And so I had the good fortune to win an NEA grant, and I thought, oh my gosh, okay, now I've got to go back to writing like poetry. And you know, the NEA has said, you are a poet and you should be doing these things. And I thought, okay, well, I should start to look at, like, I've looked a lot about my heritage in terms of England, but what have I looked at in terms of America? And I sort of set that ambition for myself. But I also said, what if I just write a book that responds to different curiosities in the world? And so Ned would often say things to me like, you haven't written about that. And like, the book starts out with a poem that's called Girl Scouts Visit the FBI. And we were watching the X-Files. And so, you know, a lot of the X-Files takes place at the FBI. And I was like, I remember visiting the FBI as a kid and when I was a Girl Scout. And, you know, this is like, you know, post 9/11. And so they don't let Girl Scouts go there anymore. And they certainly don't let Girl Scouts go to the shooting range, which we went to. So I was like, okay, I'll write that down. That would be a great subject. And then, you know, one day my daughter came home and was talking to me about reading Billy Collins' The Names with my daughter. And there's a thing about poets. Poets have mixed feelings about Billy Collins. So embarrassingly enough, I didn't know The Names. So she read the poem to me, and I was describing it to Ned because he was off teaching. And when he came home that evening, he was like, that's a great poem. You should write that down. My daughter kind of got into the game, too, of like looking for language that was interesting or situations that were peculiar. And one day we were in Target and she saw someone buying a Buddha, and she said, this, you know, for their garden, which is really like clever, but she was like, someone's buying the Buddha. Like, how weird is that? I don't buy the Buddha. And so I was like, okay, I'll write a poem about that. So I think that we do a lot of just sort of throwing ideas out there and sort of seeing like what will take and what would be fun to explore, and it kind of becomes, I think, a little bit of like a challenge and a game. Not quite a duel.
We write so differently that you know, as the other Venn diagram, there's an overlap of people that like both our poems. Usually people kind of gravitate toward one or the other, and certainly in terms of publications probably gravitate a little bit more toward my work or toward Jane's. Jane's been published in journals I will never appear in because they just don't publish work that's metrical. But then there are places like Literary Matters and so forth, where Hopkins Review, where we might both comfortably appear, but where this, if it's not now, it'll be some other time, so we can both submit and be part of it. So we're not really in kind of a direct competition, which is a good thing, I think, for our work.
Yes. I'm just moving to something else. You know, Ned, I've read your last book more recently, and I was just struck by the variety of material in it. And, you know, with that in mind, I want to, this question is for both of you. Do you help, do you give each other help in what goes into a manuscript? Because, I mean, that is how, what poems do you include? How do you arrange them, et cetera? You know, and how do each of you deal with that process?
I think Ned is he's an amazing editor. So I will get my poems together and I will sort of have an outline for a book and I will show that to him. He'll often like reshuffle it. So that's like extremely generous and extremely helpful.
Yeah, I think ever since I was a kid listening to music, you know, Ziggy Stardust and you know, concept albums, you know, like the idea of sequencing things is, as all my life, I've done it with playful ways, a little obsessive compulsive disorder perhaps, you know? Okay, we'll leave it at that, but it's very, it's useful for manuscripts though.
Yeah,
I mean,
yeah.
I feel like I've always been looking for the right order of things, set lists, like if you play in a band or if you're playing some music for folks. So I think that I do like to do it. I feel I do it well. People have said so. I've helped other friends kind of structure manuscripts. So I enjoy doing that. And obviously, I'm going to show anything I do to Jane, and Jane will say, maybe this part's not so good. Because you always need it for your own work. You need a fresh eye. Mm-hmm. You need someone else to say, hey, that's not so good. Or maybe this poem, taking a nosedive after the other one, move it or get rid of it. Because you want to have a nice mix of the major and the minor, you know, the ambitious and the throwaway, so that it's a pleasure. If anyone does take the time to read all the way through, that they have a pleasant alternation of experiences rather than being overwhelmed by too much of the same thing.
Kind of going back to the rap question for a second, I'm wondering if you can articulate, this is something I don't know how to explain for myself, like what the difference is between spoken word poetry and like what you think about spoken word poetry and like maybe what, how it differs from like reading your poetry aloud here.
Well, I think it's a great question, and I think it's the kind of thing that it's tougher to give an answer where the answer makes sense in a self-contained way than it is through the experience of listening, attending, seeing, and immersing yourself, that you start to say, oh, I can see how this is different. The way I would put it in a very kind of reductive nutshell would be, and this is not true of all performance poetry, it's certainly not true of all lines or all parts of a given performance or a given poem in performance, but if the performer is writing for performance mainly, then there are things that you can get across as an actor. I mean, they say a great actor can read the phone book. A great performer doesn't have to have every line be that tight, be that strong. And on the other hand, there are performance poets who do reach that standard. I mean, I think of someone like Eileen Miles, who's a really fine poet. And then, of course, you need to have a kind of ear for what you're looking for in poetry. I mean, we're not going to all agree on what poetry is. I mean, there are going to be lines that I say, that's a beautiful line, and you know, and you'll say, oh, that's stilted and literary, and I'll say that's a casual throwaway line that's written carelessly, and some will say, no, that's idiomatic and real and conversational. So there's going to be disagreements like that. But I think I would say that a lot of the performance poets I've heard and people that read performance poems at you know, slam readings, it's often really not about the language itself, standing up to whoever's voice reads it. So that means you go into the language itself, and then we're getting into stuff that no one wants to hear about for the next hour, but you're looking at syntax, you're looking at consonants and assonants and rhyme, you know, how are images used, what images spring to mind are generated by the work, as opposed to simple statements, even if the statements are very powerful. Very often they're slam poets will have like lots of powerful statements delivered by them, tremendous impact. Delivered by me, reading it on the page aloud, it's not going to be that great because I don't have the identity. I'm not the person. I can't deliver it the same way.
I guess that's kind of a little part of my question is, to what extent does it depend on the identity of the poet in a different way?
Probably
than,
does.
You know, it's not that it's less universal necessarily, but it just seems to have, anyway.
Oh no, I think what you're saying makes a lot of sense. I think it's hard to sort of break it down to something that's going to be universally true and agreed upon by all of us. We're going to continue to disagree in the given poem and the given performance, I think.
And I think that performance poetry does privilege the performance over, like, the craft. Although there is the best performance poets are very invested in craft in the way that comedians are invested in a kind of craft. So there's a real crossover, I think, between comedy, performance of comedy, and performance poetry. And they also will privilege political rant and autobiography in a way that maybe doesn't happen at the same level in poems that are written for the page. But then again, if we look at, you know, Ginsberg, we go back to Ginsberg, we see, well, we can't make that argument anymore. You know, his poems, like, do all of those things. So it's interesting to think about those questions. But I think when you're, and it's a challenge. I know I was judging a contest at my university for the Academy of American Poets Prize for college students. And it was interesting that one of my colleagues, whose specialty is not poetry, was pointing out that a particular piece that several other judges admired had no music. Well, there was asness and consonants, and the lines were loose iambic and loose tetrameter, but yet because it wasn't a strict form like an identifiable sonnet, that reader could not hear any music. So it's very interesting. There's a lot of questions about what we bring to the experience of reading or listening to poetry that kind of affect how we respond to it.
Yeah, I think it's better if more poets and performers are kind of in contact and crossing over and working with each other and performing together and reading each other, because then you can kind of influence each other in a constructive way rather than kind of ghettoizing it, like,
right,
you're here and I'm here, I'm literary, woo-woo, and you're not, you know, and that's not so great.
And there's people like Millay, certainly, who made a whole career, and, you know, other more contemporary people who were doing great work, who cross over.
Yeah, from the popular to the literary, yes.
So now there's so much poetry, right? I mean, I'm sorry, did somebody else have a question? Go ahead, Rachel.
I also teach, and I've noticed that students come to the classroom with a lot of resistance to reading in general and to poetry in particular. And you mentioned wanting to see your students kind of swept away by a grand love. And I was wondering, are there any poems in particular that move your students, that reach them and that kind of awaken that?
That's a great question. Unfortunately, I don't get to teach poetry enough. I teach more nonfiction than poetry. It's assigned to others in my department. But I had the experience recently of doing a writer-in-residence gig on in middle schools on the eastern shore of Maryland, and we did apocalypse poetry and eco-poetry, and one of the poems that students responded really well to was Elizabeth Bishop's The Fish, and it was amazing how they loved that poem. But I think what they were responding to was that before we read the poem, we were talking about who is in your ecotone. And so they kind of like all told little stories about the various creatures they had seen. And then when we read the poem, they were sort of seeing it as a kind of like message to them in some ways. So it made me think that one of the things that we can do when we teach is to kind of pick poems that maybe speak to students' experiences, but also open up things for them, but invite them in with some kind of conversation like that before they look at the poem as this object, you know what I mean? So they see it as a conversation, not, you know, like something they have to study, yeah.
Yeah, Robert Hayden's Those Winter Sundays is a poem that I think my students always love. Yeah. It's a beautiful poem, you may know. And among more recent poems and poets, A. Stalling, Sestina, Like.
Every
N word is the word like. Sestina, for those who don't know, is a poem with those six line stanzas. You have N words that are the same N-words in every stanza, but in a different order. But in her Sestina, every N-word is the word like.
And it's about liking on Facebook.
But it's about a lot more than that.
I did share that with students, and they did like that. Yeah.
You teach writing or you teach literature, like analyze?
I teach writing. So my job is to at Loyola University Maryland. I teach classes in intro to nonfiction. So I'm asking students to write about things in the real world, which some of them are very resistant to. They like to live in the world of the imagination. But I taught a class. But then they come to enjoy it. Because I spend a lot of time teaching lyric essays where ideas and thesis are less privileged than language. And so if people can find the joy in language and look at things on a small scale, I like to teach short forms because I think that really helps students think about the quality of each word they use. And they seem to like paradoxically enjoy that. And I did teach a class recently that was in apocalyptic and dystopian literature, but the idea of the course was that we were going to read short forms. We read poems that were apocalyptic and dystopian and some like short pieces by Ray Bradbury and other authors. And the idea was that we are under such in a period where we feel a lot of pressure, and we're used to reading short forms, so we would write in forms that would be 500 to 750 words. And they found that challenging, but powerful, and also enjoyable.
I ask you because, I think that it's interesting and difficult to define and to teach writing.
Mm-hmm.
Because some writers, as Federico García Lorca, for instance, who is a poet that personally I admire,
yes, he's wonderful.
He said that the poet itself is not the owner of the poem.
Right.
He's not the author. So basically what you have is like,
how do you say duende in English?
Duende is duende.
Duende, yes.
Which is something very mysterious.
Oh, yeah, it is.
Mysterious. You know what I mean.
One of my colleagues was fielding a course this semester, and it didn't run, and it was called Reading Like a Poet. And the idea was like you might read essays about what it means to be a poet and what it means to be an artist and how one creates and the creative process, and you probably read an article about Duende, right? But there was only two people signed up for the course. So the course didn't run, and the idea when the chair of the department asked people, like, why didn't you sign up for this course? This course is with me. You know how I am. I'm very open, blah, blah, blah. They're like, well, you know, we don't want to read. And so that was, I think, for any of us who are teachers feel a little, like, discouraged. Like, so what do we do to address this? And I think... I think we have to think about ways to kind of invite people into reading as conversation, but less about like dissecting the way that we go to the lab and kind of dissect a frog. I think we have to be more open.
Mm-hmm. Well, this has been wonderful.
Thank you for having us. It's been a pleasure.
So let's
hear your music.
Jane improvised their poetry readings. We're improvising too. So we prepared a few songs, more than two, because we wanted to see what was being appropriate. So after the readings, we looked at each other and Jonathan mentioned, why don't we do this song? So this song by Joni Mitchell.
Oh, excellent.
It's called Both Sides Now.
Oh, great. Yeah.
You can keep that there.
Okay.
Thank you. And Ned and Jane, I don't know if both of you or one of you have written poems about Joni Mitchell.
Yeah.
Ned has. Yeah. Okay, so one of the reasons why I chose the song was also because it's a beautiful song.
Yes.
Well, maybe Ned could read the poem before you sing. Can you read it?
I'd love to hear you sing it. I think there's a poetry saturation point in every poem.
So Jonathan is tuning his guitar in open tuning. So the musicians
are
not
used a lot.
I think we're doing it.
It sounds about right. Christine, I think.
Cream castles in the air and feathered canyons everywhere have looked at clouds that way. Now they only block the sun, they rain and snow on everyone. So many things I would have done, clouds got in my way. Somehow, it's cloud illusions I recall. I really don't know clouds at all. Moons and Junes and Ferris wheels, the dizzy dancing way you I looked at love that way. Now it's just another show. You leave them laughing when you go. And if you care, don't let it show. Don't give yourself away. I've looked at love from both sides now. From give and take, it's still. I really don't know love at all. Tears and fears and feeling proud to say I love you. Life that way, but now friends are acting strange. They shake their heads, they say I've changed. Well, something's lost, something's gained in living every day. I've looked at life from both sides now, from win and lose, and still somehow it's life's illusions I recall. I really don't know life at all.
I think we can all sing. We can all sing Ball in the Wind. You guys all know it, right? Who doesn't know Blown in the Wind?
How many roads must a man walk down before they call him a man? How many seas must the white dove sail before she can sleep in the sand? How many times must the cannonballs fly before they're forever banned? The answer, my friend, blowing in the wind. The answer is blowing in the wind.
Tonight, please don't hesitate to approach Ned and Jane and get their books and have them sign them. Thanks to Jonathan and Ken, our musical guests. And then a big thank you to Hearts Home and Green Door Gallery and Father Tom Vassalotti. They're in the back. Also have refreshments and book signing, but before that I'd like to remind you of our next event on Friday, May 31st, and you can see it on the programs that were left on your chair. At 8 p.m., note the time change, it says 7 p.m. there, but it's actually at 8 p.m., at 125 Maiden Lane in Lower Manhattan, Is It Possible to Work This Way? A conversation about life, purpose, and the workplace with Jostine Solheim, Executive Vice President for Food and Refreshment at Unilever, Nuno Teles, President of Diageo Beer, and Alessandro Ventura, CIO of Unilever in North America. So that's this month, May 31st in Manhattan. Also, soon we'll open submissions to our 2020 New York Encounter Poetry Contest, in which Ned was the first prize winner of 2019. If you'd like to receive information about it, at the table at the back, you could put your name and your contact information. Also, if you'd like to receive updates about our program, Crossroads program, you can also leave your name and your contact information at the back. Thank you very much, and please enjoy some refreshments, some poetry, book signing. Thank you. Tonight we have husband and wife, award-winning poets Ned BALBO and Jane SATTERFIELD. As part of this evening's collaboration, I invite you to listen to a song by the 2016 winner of the Nobel Prize for Literature, none other than Bob Dylan.
We're switching.
Okay.
We're switching.
So I'm going to let you.
Leonard Cohen first.
Leonard Cohen first. Okay. Excellent. And I introduce Ken Genuard singing and Jonathan Fields on the guitar.
I'm a commercial composer, and we were recording for American Airlines, and we had the whole orchestra out there, and they were tuning up, and the client said, I don't like it. And I said, they're tuning.
Another joke?
A drunken eight midnight choir, I have tried in my way to be free. Like a worm on a hook, like a worm on a hook, like a knight in some old-fashioned book, I have saved all my rivers for thee. And if I've been unkind, oh, that you can just let it go by. Was never to you. Like a baby stillborn, like a beast with his horn, I have torn everyone who reached out for me. But I swear by this song and by all that I have done wrong, I will not ask for so much. And a pretty woman leaning in her dark and dark, she cried out to me, hey, why not ask for more? like a drunk in a midnight choir. I have tried in my way to be free.
Thank you, Ken and Jonathan. Wonderful. So afterwards, Father Paul, do you want to talk about the paintings, or do you want to talk about it now?
As you want. What?
Yeah, you, if you want, you can mention something about the.
Yeah, I guess it's just a short introduction of where you are. As soon as the Green Door Gallery reopened just about a year ago here in the Gallery of Divine Mercy Parish, and I've been opening it with a friend of mine, Elisa Jensen, and so we take turns to curate shows. That I created a Peter show, she created this one. She's a teacher at the New York City School in Manhattan. And this is a new show, that's, so it was hanged yesterday, so she did it like, the opening is Saturday night, but she wanted to do it a little bit before so the paintings would be here for the poetry reading tonight. So she worked hard to to get everything ready so the gallery would be beautiful. Mm-hmm. And yeah, so welcome to all of you, and very happy to host the poets, Rita, Crossroads, long-time friendship, and yes, looking forward to hearing you.
Yes. Thank you, Father Paul. So, most people think of poetry as a solitary pursuit. Yet, as one of our guest poets, Jane Satterfield, says, as artists, we stand on the shoulders of giants. Poetry is a collaboration with the art that came before, but also with the created world. Our second guest poet, Ned BALBO, when speaking about his craft, explains, I try to write poems that aren't just personal, but also capture that exact moment when ordinary lives pass into history, moments that carry the imprint of those we love or who've affected us deeply. History and memory are intertwined. Tonight we have the great privilege of making history and creating memory with husband and wife team Ned and Jane as they read from their poetry, sharing who and what inspire them and how they move from inspiration to form. Now for a little biographical information. Ned BALBO's Three Knights of Persides won the 218 Richard Wilbur Award. His previous books include Upcycling Palmanook, Lives of the Sleepers, awarded the Ernest Sandine Poetry Prize, Galileo's Banquet, the Townsend University Prize co-winner, and The Trials of Edgar Poe and Other Poems, awarded the Poets Prize and the Donald Justice Prize. His next book, The Silver and Touch Me Nots, was selected for the new Criterion Poetry Prize and will appear in the fall of this year. He is the recipient of the National Endowment for the Arts Translation Fellowship for his version of Paul Valéry's La June Park, 3 Maryland Arts Council Poetry Grants, the Robert Frost Foundation Poetry Award, and the winner of the 2019 New York Encounter Poetry Contest. Ned was recently a visiting faculty member in Iowa State University's MFA program in creative writing and environment. Jane Satterfield has received awards in poetry from the NEA, Bellingham Review, Ledbury Poetry Festival, Ms. Lexia, and more. Her books of poetry are Her Familiars, Assignation at Vanishing Point, Shepherdess with an Automatic, and Apocalypse Mix, selected by David St. John for the 2016 Autumn House Poetry Prize. Jane's nonfiction has received the Florida Review Editor's Prize and Pirates Alley Faulkner Society Award. New essays are out in Hotel America, Superstition Review, Animal, A Beast of a Literary Magazine, and Diagram. With Lori Kruk, she co-edited the multi-genre anthology Borderlands and Crossroads, Writing the Motherland. And she recently taught a poetry course, Flash Fiction,
and micro-essays on apocalyptic and dystopian topics at Loyola University, Maryland, where she is an associate professor in the writing department. And now I give you Ned and Jane.
Thank you, Rita. Thank you, Father Paul. Thank you, Crossroads Cultural Centers. It's wonderful to be here. And it's been such a dark and dismal spring. It's just so wonderful to be surrounded by these beautiful colors. So I'm going to start out with a poem from my book, Apocalypse Mix, which sounds dire, but is not entirely. Both my parents' lives were deeply influenced by war. And so I think as a young person, I was very struck by the collision of history, memory, and also the way that people went to great efforts to preserve and honor community and to pay tribute to things they loved and to make the most of what they had. And this poem is called Parachute Wedding Dress. There's a parachute wedding dress example in the Smithsonian Museum, which you can look up online, and it's a beautiful example of the way that women collected parachutes and made various clothing items out of them. I have a picture of my mother as a very young child with a parachute ribbon in her hair. So this poem sort of pays tribute to that. Parachute wedding dress. More fetching than the gowns themselves, sail white and confectionery sweet, are the stories concealed in pieced panels, in cascades of hand-edged ruffled rows, the work of savvy tailors or sentimental brides whose husbands-to-be held fast to nylon or best silk that saved them as they sunk from sky to beachhead, from burning bombers to uncertain fate in freezing fields behind enemy lines. For his fiancée's dream of a white wedding dress, one survivor in a displaced persons camp traded 2 pounds of coffee beans and several packs of cigarettes for a German pilot's useless parachute. And on the close, my mother's blacked out English street, canny mothers shared out salvage fabric for hair ribbons and christening gowns. How distant now, that world of rationed goods, in museum cases, in picture perfect resolution, such economy and love handed on and handed down, its life and afterlife. And I think that a lot of what the work that we do as poets is saving that salvage fabric and honoring the people we love.
So I think we're just going to hand these back and forth, and yeah. But I wanted Jane to have a little bit of a spotlight there. It also lets me avoid the spotlight a little bit longer. So I'm not sure. We kind of looked at each other's poems and said, well, maybe we can make this a sort of coherent program. But given the folks that have shown up and what we know of some of them, and of course they're total strangers as well, I think it may be more of an improvised program than we expected,
okay.
More by free association, but maybe we'll hit on some of what we planned. So in response to that, this is a poem called Snow in Baghdad. It's a blank verse, 14-line poem, so it may be a blank verse sonnet, or if you feel strongly that sonnets must rhyme, then it's not. And it's inspired by actually a true story I read everywhere in January of 2008. There was snow in Baghdad, and the poem captures that, and I thought it was a powerful metaphor of the need for peace and how fragile and fleeting it is. So I wanted to capture that in the poem, inspired by the news stories I was reading. Snow in Baghdad. The snow so rare that people call it rain. Wet flakes touch earth and pavement, ruins and wreckage. The muezzin's call to prayer. The morning's music, calmer, quieter. 5 years of war, and now this peace, unasked for, temporary,
Americans in desert camouflage, stationed conspicuously, brushing snow from shoulders, guns, while snowball fights ensue among the young. The sound of Arabic, English in softer tones, spatter of white on impact, laughter as the traffic slows, checkpoints and concrete walls disguised, erased, and one old resident exclaims in wonder, "In all my life, I've never seen such rain." And I think that comment, calling the snow rain, seeing it as a type of rain, I found to be quite moving.
Yes. So I mentioned that my parents were deeply influenced by war. My father's American, my mother is British of Irish extraction. And I lived in the UK for a year, 1994, 1995. And that's where my daughter was born. So like myself, I was born in the UK. She has dual citizenship. And this poem kind of looks at the day that we went to file for citizenship for my daughter. And it also pays tribute a little bit to an encounter that I had with a Muslim woman who, we had a language barrier, we couldn't speak, but she wanted to talk to my daughter and see my daughter, and so the poem kind of speaks to that moment. It was a poem that I wanted to write about for many years, and it wasn't until about, I guess, about 20 years after the event took place, where there were some, the war was going on, I began to write about this, and this poem's called Triptych. I had a day's underground pass, forms to be filed for your passport. Soon we'd fly back to the States if your paperwork was in order. Your father stood watch in the embassy, ready to call us in when needed, while I wheeled you round the garden in summer's equatorial heat. I shifted the sunshade over your face. Down the path, a stranger neared, shopping bags in her hand, headscarf adorned with flowers, petals scattering light and dark. In this time before fear was everywhere, what was the reason she caught my gaze? Nearly two decades on, my screen flickers with images of crowds and crusades, flags set aflame, placards facing off outside the same American embassy, Afghanistan's the graveyard of soldiers. If you want Sharia, move to Saudi. Rage tilts toward extremes. Citizens are advised to review the worldwide caution, stay current with media coverage. The camera passes across the roiling crowd, one side against the other. Londoners who banish all immigrants, Muslim protesters garbed in white. How to speak of what we share, what separates us. If there's a woman in the crowd, I don't see her. But I remember the day I waited with the pram, how you blinked as I pulled back the sunshade and you tugged your tiny bonnet, clenched fist unfurling. In time's reflecting pool, water gathers, builds to spill. That stranger, alone, hesitant, reached in to touch your face. What was her past? A dream of mosquito nets, flashing rain, the cardamom pods she bought for her mother. She saw a mom with a pram and neared, touching the face of a stranger's baby, smiling as she said, beautiful, as she said, blessed.
I think we live in a time when a lot of not very pleasant things are happening in the news, which is a vast, vast understatement. And I think, you know, probably, you know, like a lot of white guys of my generation, you know, you want to believe, or you've grown up believing things that you now know are not true, like that mostly the police are probably to be relied upon, but every so often there are some bad ones that do awful things. And I think by now, there have been so many stories and so many things going on inescapable in the culture, so much that's been filmed and shown on video, that it's pretty hard
to live with that. I have police in my family as well, so you know it's a tough truth to face that there's such an endemic problem, such an extensive problem, so many people just being killed for no reason at all. And of course, part of the surprise of it is you would think, like, imagine yourself 20 years ago, you would think, well, gee, if this stuff was filmed on a cell phone and everybody saw it, this would stop it. It wouldn't happen anymore. And yet, it keeps happening. It keeps happening again and again. And the trials happen, and people get off, and you're just astonished how deeply ingrained it is. So this is a poem in response to that, because there's a lot in this new book, Three Nights of the Percy. It's about technology and about how it's reshaping things, perhaps for the worse. I'll read happier and funnier poems later. This is not one of them in response. But in response to your poem, which is also a political poem, this is called Cell Phones Lifted in the Public Square. What sign of progress is it when videos gone viral capture every shooting we're helpless to prevent? Our only choice to watch, refuting every frame, or look at what we see, bearing collective witness. Car keys, a toy, a wallet, some everyday possession looks just like a gun. Who wouldn't freeze, shoot first? Yes, all can be explained away ingeniously, each prop or passerby vital to the moment. Who's lost, who's culpable? The audio fades or fails, the actions blurred, unsteady. The watchful eye relentless, and right on cue it happens. A firearm's discharged, though we close our eyes, though the view is shaky. There'll be protests, altercations, alerts, and interviews. Am I next? Scrawled in chalk beside a body's outline, and flashing on phones and screens, footage that never ends. Who calls for an indictment? Who's listening? Who mourns? Soon, when twilight vigils fill the public square, challenging a narrative that casts blame on the dead, the crowd will raise its cell phones, so many they'll look like stars, viewed from far away, the distance of history. Held high, what will they offer? The light of evidence, the need for a just verdict, the promise of contrition. But the dead keep adding up, and the shootings will go on, just as they always did, obscure and unrecorded. Surveillant of lawful murder, indifferent to truth, unmoved, essential and ineffective. You shine light, but change nothing. What must change in us who bear collective witness to all this grief and guilt, inexorable as ever?
So how did you write that poem? How about that? What is the process behind that?
I declined
to answer. That's fair. A lot of people ask us questions about, like, what's it like to live with another poet, and do you give each other ideas, and things like that. So I wanted to read a poem that kind of addressed that question. But it's also a poem that looks at my father's experience. My dad was in the military. He enlisted as an 18-year-old, and he was sent to England, and that's where he met my mother. So I came back to the U.S., and I was about three. So that was one of the boons of his service. But he was called up, so he became a reservist. And then my family sort of joked around. I have four brothers, and we joked around that my dad's service as a reservist paid for our liberal arts degrees, so we are indebted to him. But during the first Gulf War, he was called up. And so this poem kind of looks at that. But several years ago, we were sort of wandering around a local store, and there was a little jar of something called Combat Ready Bomb, which had been made by someone who was a vet, and it was a salve that you could use for sand flea bites that was often sent to the service people. So Ned bought it for me and said, this would be a really good thing for you to write about, and I was like, yeah. But suddenly, I said, okay, I'll take the challenge, and I did write about the poem, and the poem also looks at the kind of balm that we seek to offer those who do military service. So this is called Combat Ready Balm. No contest at $12.50 a jar, a must-have for the medicine cabinet, soothing salve for sand flea bites, sunburn and dry skin, a cocktail of good wishes, wrapped in field green and red trim, hopeful appeasement, like the St. Christopher medal I gave my dad, after the 4:50 night's midnight call, the usual round of inoculations, the botulin and anthrax vaccines. Just like that, he was part of the mission, off to Gulf One with the military airlift command. Nothing like flying the friendly skies. Just like me, to offer an apocryphal saint as protection, a saint whose feast day was dropped from the church in record of absence of historical evidence that he'd ever existed. You've heard those stories of letters, notebooks, and Bibles tucked into breast pockets, how they could stop a bullet's path. There's no shame in sending off loved ones with a charm. Patron of travelers, invoked against storms and plagues and every etc., does it matter if Christopher's simply a stand-in for the soul treading turbulent waters? About the bomb itself, well, it's good to know it's environmentally friendly. Essential oils, no petroleum, nothing synthetic. Especially good, given the billions it costs to outfit tents with AC. Good, given the dangers to troops on the ground, whom you fuel to distant outposts via a network of slightly upgraded goat trails. I hate to think of the youths and family men and women lining up at Air Mobility Command, the same site where they filmed the video promotion for Combat Ready Bombs Operation Sand Flea. Once I boarded an Air Canada flight, a soldier smiled, looked straight into the camera, saying nothing of stress or mission fatigue, smiling in desert camos, commissioned to say how much he wants us to know how even a small thing helps. Nearly 20 years on, uniform turned in, my father still wears his medal.
This is a poem about my own dad, who I know you saw a few times, Josh, mm-hmm. back in freshman year when you were dropping me off at Vassar.
Yep.
And I'm adopted, so I don't look at all like my dad looked, which is a cause for a lot of interesting experiences in my life, I have to say. This poem actually, I think, has certainly moments that are thinking of Brooklyn. My dad grew up in a Greenpoint, but on Humboldt Street. So I'm not sure where the board boundaries are, but and I'm so angry because I didn't look at the Ancestry.com census sheets as I wanted to before I came here to find out the exact address. I know it, but I forgot to look, and I can't actually look at his house. So next time I come. And he had three sisters, and St. Teresa was his patron saint, and he always prayed to her and kept her statue mm-hmm. around. Like many Italian men of his generation, he was born in 1919. It took him probably till his 60s or 70s to really become religious, but suddenly he was very religious. And this is called A Word the Romans Used. It begins with an epigraph by Dana Gioia. The Latin word for poetry, carmen, is also the word the Romans used for a song, a magic spell, religious incantation, or prophecy. And my dad's name was Carmine. A word the Romans used. Carmen, the Latin word for poetry, is the same word the Romans used for song. My father Carmine played accordion. His sisters called him Carmen. Were they wrong to hear his music as an incantation, off the beat, bound to a single key? A magic spell, a song, a prophecy. Each holds the power to lift us. For how long, clouds breaking, did a dark sky hold the sun? Was it a star in motion all along? My father's namesake was Mount Carmel's vision. Ailing, he kept her scapular nearby, useless without the right words. When he'd pray, I'd think, words for the old or very young. Carmen, his sister smiled. They loved to listen. Carmen, Carmine, Carmel, on each tongue that knew which name to speak or leave unspoken. Mary, an apparition. Borne away, the bellows resting on his knee, he'd sway.
Who are these women she was blessed among? Each word a child speaks puts stars in motion, or twice blessed, they stay where they belong. Words bring the charm, become the talisman that summons Carmen, prayer, and poetry. That was the diatonic accordion he played, you know, so you can't really change keys, or, you know, so it's not easy.
So I wanted to read a poem that's a little bit of a love poem, and it's called "On Valentine's Day I Pick Up My Wedding Dress," and it I think it, part of it takes place in Baltimore, part of it takes place in Venice, so. And one thing that's interesting to note, that the first stanza of the poem begins with a long description of a wedding dress, and certainly one of the great ekphrastic traditions comes from, I think, the Iliad, where we get the long description of Homer's shield. And so I guess the female tradition is to describe the wedding dress. So this is "On Valentine's Day I Pick Up My Wedding Dress." Dragged across a sculpted lawn, hem half undone, the Sophia long ivory silk was smeared with August grass, a thrill to wear the empire waist with shirring at the bust, complete crossover detail and tiny shoulder pleats, the bit of luxe I delayed for months putting into the cleaner's hand. I loved how it dangled amid the darker palette of my wardrobe with its tattered trail of snails, Prosecco, pollen, one niece's sandal print, another's cookie smears. Any of my black slip dresses would have done the job, but my tween daughter said, "It's supposed to be a celebration, Mom, not a witch's Halloween." Several years ago, she and I walked with you, old friend, new love, along the Grand Canal. A wedding party's passing stopped the swirling crowds. In upraised arms, the unveiled bride held her baby girl. Noonday sun, the streets still puddled with morning's tide. But her dress, my daughter said, just ate, thinking of ruined fabric, the dirt and grime, where I thought the world's full bouquet. Today's poems in class were sex, not love. Sex and Singles Awareness Week. My cynics beyond their years didn't even Google Valentine, imprisoned bishop who worked to keep lovers' hope aflame. I gave out chocolate, wishing for some grand passion to sweep them away.
Yeah, just sort of a love poem about getting married to my husband. Just sort of, kind of. Don't hedge, please don't hedge. This is a sort of a love poem.
Sort of.
If I can find it. And a while back, Jane and I were at the Virginia Center for the Creative Arts, and I'm not the most athletic person, nor have I spent much time, you know, riding the wild range on the back of my steed. So running into a horse in the darkness, you know, seemed creepy and disturbing to me. And so even though it's called Dark Horse, which is much is as redolent, I'm sure, of George Harrison's record label and his famous single as it is of what we saw, Dark Horse, Jane and I were walking around at a writer's artist colony and saw a horse in the night. So it is what it says it is, Dark Horse. It's another blank verse, 14-line poem. This moonlit night, we've come upon a horse. His equine profile looms above barbed wire so close, we might have touched him accidentally as we pass along this country road. On foot, our flashlights, small moons flicking off. We don't want to startle him. He's still, and we can't see his eyes. Is he asleep, awake, and watching us, or in the grip of dread? He might be dangerous at night. Mm-hmm. By day, he's chestnut brown, but now he's shadow, eyes invisible, mane moonlight tinged, the hills behind him dim, vertiginous with all the history his kind have known, entwined with ours each day and every darkness.
at the same writer's colony, sometimes when you go to an artist colony, people say, why do you go with your spouse? As if your spouse is something to escape.
Surely you're here to fool around.
in a moment where I was not with my spouse at the same colony where we saw this horse, a fiction writer said to me, oh, you're a poet. I guess you're going to write about the cows in the meadow and other pastoral stuff. And I had started working on this book, which was largely about war. So I thought, oh, this would be very funny. I'll explain to this fiction writer why I don't write nature poems. And so this is why I don't write nature poems. Because I'm always wearing the wrong shoes, I rarely stray from the path. There's recollect, there's tranquility, and the way the trains punctuate each hour, shrill the shaken fields. Let's bide a bit here, thinking why we love them, the tracks, the transit. Trains a metaphor for so many things in life, like me. Busy eyeing up the buffet from the back of the line, too busy to consider a phalanx of flocks, the tabby stray cavorting in the hedge. I don't see a cow meadow as any kind of invocation. I'm drawn to the satellite dish disrupting the view, to the one swatch of sky where the haze hangs, because truly, the one time I tried, the saddled mare extended an answer, his hoof on my foot, a fine form. Because the genius of the place can drop a scroll of sycamore bark at my feet, and I still can't translate his tongue. Because a cicada's buzz in the topmost branch is all the intel left to get, trilling a telling, here, here, I am here.
So I'm open to some other singing here. Find it. Here we go. I promised I would read a poem about Vassar. This one contains the F word. Can I read that? Or should I just mouth it?
No.
Why don't I just mouth it?
Father Paul said okay.
It's okay. Josh, I don't know if you were there. This is a Patty in Orbit. It takes place at the Vassar College Chapel, April 7th, 1979. I'm a big Patti Smith fan. This was not a tour in which she was at her best. There's actually a wonderful account of it in the Vassar Miscellany News, the college newspaper. I stole a few lines from it and actually gave credit to the author, David Duncan, in the notes, so I'm not just a plagiarist. In case you're wondering, this is in sapphic stanzas. If you don't care, that's fine too. Patty in Orbit, Vassar College Chapel, April 7, 1979. And it also helps to know that she has a song called Space Monkey on her album Easter. And it's exactly what you'd expect it to be about. Patty, what was audible past the ceiling? Beams of dark wood, terminal angels watching from above, winged guardians halved and gilded, space monkeys feedback? Fixed on high, celestially overhead, blank faces stayed blank, glimmers of stage lights flashing over us, your audience in the chapel. Why were you awful? You were high too, obvious from your banter. Where are all the good-looking models? Fuck it, I don't feel like reading tonight. Your book slammed shut as the band played fiercely, stoned too, high on rebellion, missing half its text, the poem at its core and climax. Strobe lit Len, guitarist of poison power, drug-dazzled, soloed. How high were we after such hype and clamor? Were you crashing, spiraling downward fast, or off course temporarily? Mm-hmm. No, I never play a gig just for women, or play only for humans, either. You replied to stage crowding hedonists. What did my girlfriend, classically trained pianist, think of this bedlam? She took things in stride, a distinct advantage at that time for anyone dating me. But where was he, ape avatar, fueled and starstruck, racing the night sky? Patty, close to spinning away, you landed safe and sober, marrying in Detroit Fred Sonic Smith,
typed pages and more. Smiths followed, raising a family, music on hold. This was the life that saved you and the choice that later on left you widowed, fired with grief, inspired to resume recording after the fade out fades out. What's next? Maplethorpe, memoir, tributes, time bearing down. Space monkey, high that evening, locked in quaalude orbit beyond the solar asteroid belt, or radar jammed, craft plunged in Pacific waters, sky blue by day. Alien ape, lost pilot, will we know you? Simian gold and glowing when you appear? Or will Patty summon you back to grimace at the sight of what was but one more planet on your journey, no more or less important when it's forgotten? And the locked in quaalude orbit beyond the solar asteroid belt is the line by David. So it sort of suggests a rhythm. So there you go, the one with the sapphics. Now I'm not quite sure how much time we have. We certainly don't want to, like, you know, read you into numbness. Obviously, Rita asked us to talk a little bit about how our poems are composed, a little bit about our process. She said there'd be a Q&A. So maybe we should read each maybe one more poem, and then we'll take questions if there are any. It also gives you a little pause in case you want to slip away. And, you know, perhaps you have other things to do. That's okay, too. So, go with Emily.
Okay. So I was just telling a few people that part of the joy of this week, aside from finishing a teaching semester, was that I was able to work in the New York Public Library's Bird Collection and look at some poems and manuscripts by Emily Bronte. I'm working on a new project inspired by the Bronte family and the way it's sort of looking at neo-Victorian legacy and the way these this family's lives sort of proliferate in the 20th century and the questions they raise about biography. And I've been fascinated for them probably my whole life, and I said, you know what, I'm just gonna like write about them. It doesn't matter whether anyone cares. So it's been a joy to go to the library and the Bird Collection, and they let you into the archive and you see they bring out pieces bit by bit. You know, you can't look at everything all at once, which of course if you're a poet you want to see it all. And you have to like fill out little call forms, which are very specific. You have to get them right or the librarian will correct you. So it feels a little bit like being in school, but then they bring out these pieces, little torn shreds and pieces. And you can see that people in the Victorian era are so careful about their use of paper, right? Because paper is very expensive, paper and ink. And so just looking at these little slips and time kind of drops away. So that's part of the project I've been working on. And a poem that I wrote early in the collection was inspired by reading Emily Bronte by Long Island Sound. There's a wonderful conference called Poetry by the Sea, which is on the Long Island Sound, and it takes place at the Mercy Sisters Retreat House, and it's sponsored by a friend of ours, Kim Bridgeford. And it's a wonderful conference. In fact, it's the only literary conference I've been able to go to where I actually can write something. That's how peaceful it is. So anyway, this is that poem, Reading Emily Bronte by Long Island Sound. Life is short and art is all, and the day is dazzling, a glassine surface. The clouds a mottled counterpane, the few spays blue, ring-billed gulls parse the tide. No lark or heather bells, just the ages where the seasons swing. You walked away from village chatter toward the waterfall's campaign, up moorland paths where a wind beat a path through grass. Such license in stolen afternoons, where you saw hidden constellations, the silver trail of snails, a fistful of bees roused from sleep. Your dress was a welter of thunder clouds and lightning bolts. Today, on claws and flutter sleeves, would you say the here and now's a horizon to eternity? An ancient ice sheaf engineered this estuary, a sheltered tide that slows the pulse, one mercy in a warming season.
Jane says I should end with this one, so I will. This is a sonnet about a bar in Iowa, but I think it's universal in the lament that it offers. Time's passage at Whiskey River, and of course the epigraph is free beer tomorrow. We've all seen that sign. And suddenly at 12:01 felt that terrible disappointment when tomorrow was suddenly today and no free beer was
for tomorrow.
You know, when we realized we've been tricked yet again by the world. Time's passage at Whiskey River. I read the sign, it's late, tomorrow's near. The beer's flat, no one taps another keg. The shortstop stumbles on the runner's leg while frozen strangers balance at the bar, slow motion gestures wasted on the air. Outside, the tattooed girl takes one more drag while friendly foes attack the punching bag that offers glory to the challenger with change to spare. Surprised, the shortstop blinks, eyes flashing back and forth in diamond dust. Young men with sunken cheeks wait for the drinks the tattooed girl withholds, because she must, when all our hopes past midnight turn to sorrow. There's no free beer today. And none tomorrow. Thank you, Rita. Thank you, Father. Music we had playing us in. I'm not sure if now's the moment for more music or if that's going to come soon.
Well, we're going to have Q&A.
Okay, Q&A.
And then we'll have music, and then we'll have food, right?
Oh,
and
free wine. Free
wine. And wine.
Free wine today.
Yes.
Yeah, today.
Yes, today at 12. So actually, could I begin with a question?
Absolutely.
My question is, when you... I'll throw it to both of you and whoever wants to field it. When you have an idea for a poem, how do you know if you want it to be a sonnet or you want it to be, you know, a couplet or a free verse, or like, how do you know the form that the poem is going to take?
That's a great question. and I'm thinking, like, primarily I write free verse, but I'm very interested in, and from going to writers' colonies, I've discovered that my process is very similar to composers. From what they tell me, like, they hear, like, they have a sense of a theme and what they want to explore, and then they wait for the music. And they're sort of crafting toward sustaining that music across the line. And that's kind of what I do with free verse. So often it's about knowing and being obsessed with a subject and feeling compelled by a subject and getting a title and a first line that set the music. And then I've got to go from there. Other times I have a sense that I'm working with a subject that fits a particular literary form. I like forms of repetition like pantoum or villanelle, where there's repetition and refrains that are set. When I'm working on this project about Emily Bronte, for example, I thought, I want to write a poem about the Kate Bush video, Wuthering Heights. Many people probably know that 1980s famous video. And there's actually flash mobs that recreate that video. So I thought, oh, that seems to lend itself really well to the structure of the villanelle, which has like the first and third line repeating, and then it goes through several stanzas. For me, like, maybe that's kind of how things work, but you work more strictly in forms than in meter.
Since my 30s, I've been, and I think I would say that if you're, I think when I was first starting out, I would often choose subjects that didn't fit the form of what I was trying to write in. If I had a very specific subject, a specific idea, and so then I would say that if it wasn't working, then I would either write a poem that didn't work, or I would switch to a different form that I thought would fit better. So, for example, if it was a lot of narrative and it turned out to be, you know, too heavy for a sonnet, then I'm like, okay, maybe I'll turn this into a blank verse poem because I'll have a lot of room for it, or a free verse poem too. I've certainly turned bad
blank verse poems into better free verse poems and publish them too. That's happened a few times also when there's just too much filler and my skill just wasn't there, you know. But then sometimes you get the sense of like, oh, this will either match the form. I just have a moment I want to write about.
Like, and so, Free Beer Today.
Free Beer Today. This is not an epic. You know? It needs something short, tight, move on. No, that's the
jingle.
Best.
Yeah. Yeah.
A jingle. There you go. Yeah. Look, there you go. And you would know.
Yeah.
If you ever need a lyricist. You know. but in any case. But then, you know, other things obviously demand more, and you want more room for them. So in that case, maybe poems of indefinite length can help. If there's some weird thing that keeps happening or can be varied upon, then poems with refrains that repeat mm-hmm. themselves can be very useful because, oh, you can keep returning to this and it will come back in a different form. And in the case of the poem I read about Patti Smith, then, you know, there was a line in an article on the concert that suggested a music. I said, oh, well, this is a trochaic sound, so it fits sapphic stanzas, and I think that will be. And I remember the question that the women in the front row had asked, you know, would you give a concert for women? And she said, but I wouldn't give it for you. Wouldn't do it only for humans either. And so I thought, oh well, this kind of fits then. It's kind of like the sort of connection of, you know, women's experience. You know, she's a woman artist, so I thought that would fit. And that was also, and it's also sapphic stanzas, but I could write as many as I wanted, so I could like fit the narrative into them.
Mm-hmm. Thank you. John.
You talk about music a lot, and you just brought up rhythm. Do you have any opinions on rap as poetry?
Oh. Yeah. Well, I mean, my opinion is, let's see. I mean, I think that rap is purely great. And I think it obviously depends on the artist, just like whether it's music. I mean,
right, the form itself, the approach, what you guys do.
It's something entirely different. I mean, and I don't think that it's. I think that the way I usually put it to my students is that if you have rap or you have lyrics in a song, there's a tremendous overlap with which poetry is. If you drew a Venn diagram and you said, you know, rap and, you know, song lyrics, you know, poetry, and there'd be overlap. You know, but there are some things that work in rap or that work in song lyrics that don't work in poetry. And also there's stuff in poetry that doesn't work when it's sung. I mean, I can think of some Dylan Thomas poems I've heard set to music by John Cale, and they're so densely verbal that the sounds are too sonorous and too heavy to be sung comfortably.
I thought that about poetry too. It has so much content.
Yeah.
Music, it's hard to find the music.
Nah. Right, and if you have lots of Lou Reed lyrics, you know, and they don't read very well as poetry, I would argue. But I think that they're, you know, they sound great in songs.
Mm-hmm.
And I think the same thing is true in rap. But I think that I think also there's an interesting thing going on in the culture where people use what defines poetry as a way to sort of gain some kind of higher ground. And the reason I say it that way is people say, well, this is poetry, but that's not.
Mm-hmm.
So someone says, well, rap is not poetry. It sounds like an insult, and it shouldn't be, because I think that, you know, rap is sort of connected to performance.
Mm-hmm.
And so if you sing a song and it's connected to performance, and you rap and it's connected to your performance, and the voice of the performer, the presence of the performer, that's all part of it. It's all connected. A poem that, like the kind I write, that I do and a lot of literary folks do, we're trying to write something that anyone could read it, and it would somehow have a music to it.
It's not performer.
Whereas the performer is like putting the music sometimes in, but not always, because as I said, there's a Venn diagram of overlap with a lot of great language that's going to be in all of them.
Well, look at Lin-Manuel Miranda
in
Hamilton, where you see the use of rap and all those conventions, and the rhyme is providing tension for the narrative, and it's driving the narrative forward, and it's framing it in very interesting and syntactical ways. And I know sometimes I'll have students who want to use the conventions of rap, but they're writing toward the rhyme, and the rhyme is dictating the piece. And I know Charles Martin has talked about sometimes, he's a wonderful translator, but you have to sacrifice the rhyme for the greater goal of the art. And I think, you know, Hamilton is a great example of how the best rap can really work,
you know, I'm not immersed in rap, but, you know, I think of like albums like Jay-Z's Black Album, an autobiographical album of his life, which I think is really powerful and really, I don't have to say is this poetry or not. I just think it's a great album, and the songs are great.
The Fugees,
Okay,
certainly.
Yeah. Yeah. We show our age. Our age,
yeah.
The 90s. What can you say?
Yeah.
You had a beautiful example about the sand flea bomb.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
I loved Ned picking up the product and the receptivity with which you
took up the assignment.
Could you talk a little more about how you collaborate and the kinds of ideas you give to each other that way and so forth?
Well, I'll start and you continue.
Absolutely.
Jane will encourage me. So for example, I like conspiracy theories and strange lies and things that people believe that can't possibly be true, but they believe it anyway. So I was talking about people that don't believe that the moon landing never happened. And, you know, and I do a lot of improvising of, you know, what can only be called bullshit, like with my wife, you know, just to entertain her. And so I said, oh, you should put that in a poem. So I stayed up one night and said, okay, I'm going to write this. I wrote a poem called The Lunar Deniers, which is going to be the forthcoming book about folks that just don't believe in these. This guy is very reasonably explaining how it never happened, and of course it's all a fake. So there's things like that. That's one example from my life.
Yeah. I know, like, this book, Her Familiars, I think this book is an example of a book where I kind of took up the assignments. I've been writing a memoir and doing a lot of nonfiction. I wrote a nonfiction memoir and was teaching a lot of nonfiction. And so I had the good fortune to win an NEA grant, and I thought, oh my gosh, okay, now I've got to go back to writing like poetry. And you know, the NEA has said, you are a poet and you should be doing these things. And I thought, okay, well, I should start to look at, like, I've looked a lot about my heritage in terms of England, but what have I looked at in terms of America? And I sort of set that ambition for myself. But I also said, what if I just write a book that responds to different curiosities in the world? And so Ned would often say things to me like, you haven't written about that. And like, the book starts out with a poem that's called Girl Scouts Visit the FBI. And we were watching the X-Files. And so, you know, a lot of the X-Files takes place at the FBI. And I was like, I remember visiting the FBI as a kid and when I was a Girl Scout. And, you know, this is like, you know, post 9/11. And so they don't let Girl Scouts go there anymore. And they certainly don't let Girl Scouts go to the shooting range, which we went to. So I was like, okay, I'll write that down. That would be a great subject. And then, you know, one day my daughter came home and was talking to me about reading Billy Collins' The Names with my daughter. And there's a thing about poets. Poets have mixed feelings about Billy Collins. So embarrassingly enough, I didn't know The Names. So she read the poem to me, and I was describing it to Ned because he was off teaching. And when he came home that evening, he was like, that's a great poem. You should write that down. My daughter kind of got into the game, too, of like looking for language that was interesting or situations that were peculiar. And one day we were in Target and she saw someone buying a Buddha, and she said, this, you know, for their garden, which is really like clever, but she was like, someone's buying the Buddha. Like, how weird is that? I don't buy the Buddha. And so I was like, okay, I'll write a poem about that. So I think that we do a lot of just sort of throwing ideas out there and sort of seeing like what will take and what would be fun to explore, and it kind of becomes, I think, a little bit of like a challenge and a game. Not quite a duel.
We write so differently that you know, as the other Venn diagram, there's an overlap of people that like both our poems. Usually people kind of gravitate toward one or the other, and certainly in terms of publications probably gravitate a little bit more toward my work or toward Jane's. Jane's been published in journals I will never appear in because they just don't publish work that's metrical. But then there are places like Literary Matters and so forth, where or Hopkins Review, where we might both comfortably appear, but where there's, if it's not now, it'll be some other time, so we can both submit and be part of it. So we're not really in kind of a direct competition, which is a good thing, I think, for our work.
Yes. I'm just moving to something else. You know, Ned, I've read your last book more recently, and I was just struck by the variety of material in it. And, you know, with that in mind, this question is for both of you. Do you give each other help in what goes into a manuscript? Because, I mean, what poems do you include? How do you arrange them, et cetera? How do each of you deal with that process?
Ned is he's an amazing editor. So I will get my poems together and I will sort of have an outline for a book and I will show that to him. He'll often like reshuffle it. So that's like extremely generous and extremely helpful.
Yeah, I think ever since I was a kid listening to music, you know, Ziggy Stardust and concept albums, like the idea of sequencing thing is, as all my life, I've done it with playful ways, a little obsessive compulsive disorder perhaps, okay, we'll leave it at that, it's useful for manuscripts though.
Yeah,
I mean,
yeah.
I feel like I've always been looking for the right order of things, set lists, like if you play in a band or if you're playing some music for folks, so I think that I do like to do it, I feel I do it well, people have said so. I've helped other friends kind of structure manuscripts. So I enjoy doing that. And obviously, I'm going to show anything I do to Jane, and Jane will say, maybe this part's not so good. Because you always need it for your own work. You need a fresh eye. Mm-hmm. You need someone else to say, hey, that's not so good. Or maybe this poem, taking a nosedive after the other one, move it or get rid of it. Because you want to have a nice mix of the major and the minor, the ambitious and the throwaway, so that it's a pleasure. If anyone does take the time to read all the way through, that they have a pleasant alternation of experiences rather than being overwhelmed by too much of the same thing.
Kind of going back to the rap question for a second, I'm wondering if you can articulate something I don't know how to explain for myself, like what the difference is between spoken word poetry and like what you think about spoken word poetry and like maybe what, how it differs from like reading your poetry aloud here.
Mm. Well, I think it's a great question, and I think it's the kind of thing that it's tougher to give an answer where the answer makes sense in a self-contained way than it is through the experience of listening, attending, seeing, and immersing yourself, that you start to say, oh, I can see how this is different. The way I would put it in a very kind of reductive nutshell would be, and this is not true of all performance poetry, it's certainly not true of all lines or all parts of a given performance or a given poem in performance, but if the performer is writing for performance mainly, then there are things that you can get across as an actor. I mean, they say a great actor can read the phone book. A great performer doesn't have to have every line be that tight, be that strong. And on the other hand, there are performance poets who do reach that standard. I mean, I think of someone like Eileen Miles, who's a really fine poet. And then, of course, you need to have a kind of ear for what you're looking for in poetry. I mean, we're not going to all agree on what poetry is. I mean, there are going to be lines that I say, that's a beautiful line, and you'll say, oh, that's stilted and literary, and I'll say, that's a casual throwaway line that's written carelessly, and some will say, no, that's idiomatic and real and conversational. So there's going to be disagreements like that. But I think I would say a lot of the performance poets I've heard and people that read performance poems at slam readings, it's often really not about the language itself, standing up to whoever's voice reads it. So that means you go into the language itself, and then we're getting into stuff that no one wants to hear about for the next hour, but you're looking at syntax, you're looking at consonants and assonants and rhyme, how are images used, what images spring to mind are generated by the work, as opposed to simple statements, even if the statements are very powerful. Very often they're slam poets will have like lots of powerful statements delivered by them, tremendous impact. Delivered by me, reading it on the page aloud, it's not going to be that great because I don't have the identity. I'm not the person. I can't deliver it the same way.
I guess that's kind of a little part of my question is, to what extent does it depend on the identity of the poet in a different way?
Probably
than,
does.
It's not that it's less universal necessarily, but it just seems to have, anyway.
Oh no! I think what you're saying makes a lot of sense. I think it's hard to sort of break it down to something that's going to be universally true and agreed upon by all of us. We're going to continue to disagree in the given poem and the given performance, I think.
Okay.
And I think that performance poetry does privilege the performance over like the craft. Although there is the best performance poets are very invested in craft in the way that comedians are invested in a kind of craft. So there's a real crossover, I think, between comedy, performance of comedy, and performance poetry. And they also will privilege political rant and autobiography in a way that maybe doesn't happen at the same level in poems that are written for the page. But then again, if we look at, you know, Ginsberg, we go back to Ginsberg, we see, well, we can't make that argument anymore. You know, his poems, like, do all of those things. So it's interesting to think about those questions. But I think when you're, and it's a challenge. I know I was judging a contest at my university for the Academy of American Poets Prize for college students. And it was interesting that one of my colleagues, whose specialty is not poetry, was pointing out that a particular piece that several other judges admired had no music. Well, there was asness and consonants, and the lines were loose iambic and loose tetrameter, but yet because it wasn't a strict form like an identifiable sonnet, that reader could not hear any music. So it's very interesting. There's a lot of questions about what we bring to the experience of reading or listening to poetry that kind of affect how we respond to it.
Yeah, yeah, I think it's better if more poets and performers are kind of in contact and crossing over and working with each other and performing together and reading each other, because then you can kind of influence each other in a constructive way rather than kind of ghettoizing it. Like,
right,
you're here and I'm here, I'm literary, woo-woo, and you're not, you know, and that's not so great.
And there's people like Millay, certainly, who made a whole career, and, you know, other more contemporary people who were doing great work, who cross over.
Yeah, from the popular to the literary,
So now there's so much poetry. Right?
Yeah.
I mean, I'm sorry. Did somebody else have a question?
Go ahead, Rachel.
I also teach, and I've noticed that students come to the classroom with a lot of resistance to reading in general and to poetry in particular. And you mentioned wanting to see your students kind of swept away by a grand love. And I was wondering, are there any poems in particular that move your students, that reach them and that kind of awaken that?
That's a great question. Unfortunately, I don't get to teach poetry enough. I teach more nonfiction than poetry. It's assigned to others in my department. But I had the experience recently of doing a writer-in-residence gig on in middle schools on the eastern shore of Maryland, and we did apocalypse poetry and eco-poetry, and one of the poems that students responded really well to was Elizabeth Bishop's The Fish, and it was amazing how they loved that poem. But I think what they were responding to was that before we read the poem, we were talking about who is in your ecotone. And so they kind of like all told little stories about the various creatures they had seen. And then when we read the poem, they were sort of seeing it as a kind of like message to them in some ways. So it made me think that one of the things that we can do when we teach is to kind of pick poems that maybe speak to students' experiences, but also open up things for them, but invite them in with some kind of conversation like that before they look at the poem as this object, you know what I mean? So they see it as a conversation, not, you know, like something they have to study, yeah.
Yeah, Robert Hayden's Those Winter Sundays
is
a poem that I think my students always love.
Yeah.
It's a beautiful poem, you may know. And among more recent poems and poets, A. Stalling, Sestina, Like.
Every
N-word is the word like. Sestina, for those who don't know, is a poem with those six-line stanzas, that you have N-words that are the same N-words in every stanza, but in a different order. But in her Sestina, every N-word is the word like.
And it's about liking on Facebook.
But it's about a lot more than that.
Did share that with students,
students
did like that. Yeah.
I mean, do you teach writing, or do you teach literature? analyze?
I teach writing, so my job is to, at Loyola University Maryland, I teach classes in intro to nonfiction, so I'm asking students to write about things in the real world, which some of them are very resistant to. They like to live in the world of the imagination. But I taught a class, but then they come to enjoy it. Because I spend a lot of time teaching lyric essays where ideas and thesis are less privileged than language. And so if people can find the joy in language and look at things on a small scale, I like to teach short forms because I think that really helps students think about the quality of each word they use. And they seem to like paradoxically enjoy that. And I did teach a class recently that was in apocalyptic and dystopian literature, but the idea of the course was that we were going to read short forms. We read poems that were apocalyptic and dystopian and some like short pieces by Ray Bradbury and other authors. And the idea was that we are under such a, in a period where we feel a lot of pressure, and we're used to reading short forms, so we would write in forms that would be 500 to 750 words. And they found that challenging, but powerful, and also enjoyable.
I ask you because, I think that it's interesting and difficult to define and to teach writing.
Mm-hmm.
Because some writers, as Federico García Lorca, for instance, who is a poet that personally I admire,
yes, he's wonderful.
He said that the poet itself is not the owner of the poem.
Right.
He's not the author. So basically what you have is like, how do you say duende?
Duende is duende.
Duende, yes.
Which is something very mysterious.
Oh, yeah, it is.
Mysterious. Yeah, you know what I mean.
One of my colleagues was fielding a course this semester, and it didn't run, and it was called Reading Like a Poet. And the idea was like you might read essays about what it means to be a poet and what it means to be an artist and how one creates and the creative process, and you probably read an article about Duende, right? But there was only two people signed up for the course. So the course didn't run, and the idea when the chair of the department asked people, like, why didn't you sign up for this course? This course is with me. You know how I am. I'm very open, blah, blah, blah. They're like, well, you know, we don't want to read. And so that was, I think, for any of us who are teachers feel a little, like, discouraged. Like, so what do we do to address this? And I think... I think we have to think about ways to kind of invite people into reading as conversation, but less about like dissecting the way that we go to the lab and kind of dissect a frog. I think we have to be more open.
Mm-hmm. Well, this has been wonderful.
Thank you for having us. It's been a pleasure.
So let's
hear your music.
Jane improvised their poetry readings. We're improvising too. So we prepared a few songs, more than two, because we wanted to see what was being appropriate. So after the readings, we looked at each other and Jonathan mentioned, why don't we do this song? So this song is by Joni Mitchell.
Oh, excellent.
It's called Both Sides Now.
Oh, right. Okay.
You can keep that there.
Okay.
Thank you. And Ned and Jane, I don't know if both of you or one of you have written poems about Joni Mitchell.
Yeah.
Ned has.
Ned.
Okay, so one of the reasons why I chose the song is also because it's a beautiful song.
Yes.
Well, maybe Ned could read the poem before you sing. Can you read it?
I'd love to hear you sing it. I think there's a poetry saturation point in every poem.
Jonathan is tuning his guitar in open tuning, so for the musicians
Joni Mitchell used a lot.
I think we're doing it. That sounds about right. Christine, I think.
Go.
And ice cream castles in the air, and feathered canyons everywhere. I've looked at clouds that way, now they only block the sun. They rain and snow on everyone. So many things I would have done. Clouds got in my way. Somehow, it's clouds' illusions I recall. I really don't know clouds at all. Moons and Junes and Ferris wheels, the dizzy dancing way you I looked at love that way. Now it's just another show. You leave them laughing when you go. And if you care, don't let it show. Don't give yourself away. I've looked at love from both sides now. From give and take, yet still. I really don't know love at all. Tears and fears and feeling proud to say I love you. Life that way, but now friends are acting strange. They shake their heads, they say I've changed. Well, something's lost, something's gained in living every day. I look at life from both sides now, from win and lose, and still somehow it's life's illusions I recall. I really don't know life at all.
I think we can all sing. We can all sing Ball in the Wind. You guys all know it, right? Who doesn't know Blowing in the Wind?
How many roads must a man walk down before they call him a man? How many seas must the white dove sail before she can sleep in the sand? How many times must the cannonballs fly before they're forever banned? The answer, my friend, blowing in the wind. The answer is blowing in the wind. How many years must a mountain exist before it's washed out to the sea?
take till he knows that too many people have died. The answer, my friend, is blowing in the wind. The answer is blowing in the wind. The answer, my friend, is blowing in the wind. The answer is blowing in the wind.
So we have, thank you very much to our guest poets, Ned and Jane. And they will be available in the room here. They have books. They will sign them for you. So if you want to see more of what you heard tonight, please don't hesitate to approach Ned and Jane and get their books and have them sign them. Thanks to Jonathan and Ken, our musical guests. And then a big thank you to Hearts Home and Green Door Gallery and Father Tom Vassalotti. They're in the back. Also have refreshments and book signing, but before that I'd like to remind you of our next event on Friday, May 31st, and you can see it on the programs that were left on your chair. At 8 p.m., note the time change, it says 7 p.m. there, but it's actually at 8 p.m., at 125 Main Lane in Lower Manhattan, Is It Possible to Work This Way? A conversation about life, purpose, and the workplace with Jostine Solheim, Executive Vice President for Food and Refreshment at Unilever, Nuno Teles, President of Diageo Beer, and Alessandro Ventura, CIO of Unilever in North America. So that's this month, May 31st in Manhattan. Also, soon we'll open submissions to our 2020 New York Encounter Poetry Contest, in which Ned was the first prize winner of 2019. If you'd like to receive information about it, at the table at the back, you could put your name and your contact information. Also, if you'd like to receive updates about our program, Crossroads program, you can also leave your name and your contact information at the back. Thank you very much, and please enjoy some refreshments, some poetry, book signing. Thank you.